Hi, I'm Fred McNeil, and thank you for watching QACTV 7. You're watching a program called Conversations with Fred. Every week, we bring in people from the community to talk about things that I think is going to make your life easier, and they're certainly going to be interesting. What we're doing over the next couple shows, we have people coming from Chesapeake College, the local Queen Anne's County Board of Education, the private schools in the area. We've kind of made the next 30 days education time. I'm delighted to have with me today Dr. Clifford Coppersmith. And Doc, thank you for being with us. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Fred.
We've been talking off the air, and this is kind of fun. We have a lot of things in common. But let me ask Dr. Coppersmith, how about for people who might not know you, I know you've been at Chesapeake College, you told me 4 years, where you're from, where you went to school, and maybe pre-Chesapeake College, anything you'd like to talk about?
Sure, just as we just discussed, I was born in the West Indies, my dad worked for Texaco Oil, we had connections to the colonial
government. And I want you to know, I want the audience to know, we spent the whole 15 minutes before you saying Coppersmith. He's got to be Lord Clifford Coppersmith of Londonshire or something.
Well, that's another story. But okay. Born abroad, but moved to the States when I was about 4 years of age. More or less settled down in Western New York after some moving around with my parents as a young child. And graduated from Olean Senior High School. And had a great life. Olean was a classic rural kind of town.
And St. Bonaventure is right in?
St. Bonaventure is, that's actually a family alma mater for us.
And Thomas Merton, who many people Thomas know that Merton. Name, is a great author and a cleric. And of course, the best story is Bob Lanier's shoe. Please
sure.
tell me about
well,
that.
Well, Bob Lanier actually played at St. Bonaventure, probably one of the most famous.
And you guys were great teams.
Players came out of there. Bonas has had on and off some really great basketball over the years. And I kind of grew up on it. My grandfather would take me to the games when I was a kid. He worked at St. Bonaventure as a math teacher after retiring from the military. So St. Bonaventure's in my DNA. My parents are both grads. My dad or grandfather taught there. My aunt actually just until recently worked there, working in the president's office. And so it's just, it's a great connection to our family.
Part of the DNA almost.
It is. Okay. And so I did my graduate degree there in history. Had a great experience there. But Olean was a great town to grow up in as a kid.
Is it a small town?
It's very small.
Very small.
About 20,000 people when I was growing up.
Now, how close do the map work? How close to the Canadian border? Are you close or not?
Niagara Falls is probably about two and a half hours away.
Oh, so you're quite close.
Right on the Pennsylvania border.
Oh, Pennsylvania
It's
border.
The southern tier of New York. Okay. And Pennsylvania, literally a 10-minute drive from Olean.
Okay, all right. So. Now, what was the bug of education? Teaching first?
I'm third-generation college.
Oh, okay.
My grandfather attended Purdue University. He was our first generation to go to college. He was an electrical engineer, ended up going in the military as an officer. My mother's a grad and actually graduated from St. Bonaventure. And of course, I just, for
it's
me...
Again, another DNA thing.
Yeah, growing up in my house, you just weren't going anywhere else.
Okay.
And so from there, I think academic life has been part of my family. My grandfather taught math. My mother's a teacher. I started out as a faculty member before getting into administrative work. So that kind of, you know, after a lot of journeys around the country and military service and government service, I graduated.
Let me just interrupt for a second. I say history. No, my wife retired as an AP history teacher.
Okay.
So the conversation I have every single night, I want you to know my dinner table is much like graduate course history 406.
Sure.
Did you specialize in a period in history?
My PhD is in Native American history in the American West.
Native American.
And I did my dissertation was a study of the Chiricahua Apache in Oklahoma.
Oh, wow, that would have been interesting.
And I've had a strong affinity for Native American history since I was a kid.
Okay.
Olean is right on the Allegheny Reservation, which is where the Seneca Indians have a reservation to this day. And I had a Seneca friend. And for whatever reason, always gravitated towards
Native
American.
What's your favorite Native American historical fact or story that you want to share with me?
Well, my dissertation's about these
about
folks. This is Geronimo's community.
The Geronimo.
Okay. They were the last Indian community to surrender after 30 years of Indian wars in the American West. And they were actually imprisoned as prisoners of war for over 30 years.
The whole tribe was?
The whole community, 400 individuals. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, they ended up at Fort Sill, and around 1913, they were finally liberated, and part of the community went back to New Mexico, more or less near the region that they were associated with historically, and the other half roughly stayed in Oklahoma, and that was the history I wrote was of that community that's still there today.
Stayed in Oklahoma.
Yep.
Now, I thought, as a kid, I used to go to Florida. My dad would take me to Key West, Florida, every winter.
Sure.
I thought one of the saddest things, in my opinion, I believe they were Seminole tribe.
Sure.
They used to sell trinkets and little bows and arrows, which was a thrill as a child. But when you realize how they lived and how we treated them, it was kind of tragic. How are we doing any better in Oklahoma or out west?
Well, it's a struggle today. I've spent a lot of time in Indian country. Most recently, before I came to Chesapeake, I was out in Montana for 3 years. And, you know, it's a struggle. There's a lot of poverty.
You know, you're going to have to, excuse me again for interrupting. Matt Rosendale, you might have seen in Centerville. Do you know about Matt?
Okay. Yeah, he ran for office out there.
He got elected House of Representatives.
Sure.
Now, forgetting the politics, Matt was a local realtor.
Sure.
Now, my wife actually was teaching and working with him. But if you haven't yet, please call his office. He'll tell you Montana stories. He's a delight.
Sure.
Politics aside, whether you like him or dislike him, he's just a good person. So tell him you're the president of Chesapeake College. He'll probably treat you to a steak dinner.
Okay, we'll do that.
Or buy a house from Mosendale Realty. All right. What was the, obviously you're in love with that whole topic. What was the bug to get you in administration?
Well, I refer to myself as the accidental dean.
Okay.
I was actually drafted to be an interim vice president at College of Eastern Utah, basically from the ranks of faculty. I had very little formal leadership experience in academia, other than serving in faculty senate and those kinds of things. But I had a lot of military training as a leader, and I think that served me very well.
Can you talk a little bit about your military career?
Sure.
I mean, you're doing... some interesting work, it sounds like.
Well, 12 years, I enlisted in the New York Army National Guard, largely to pay for school.
And you were an enlisted man?
And I was an enlisted man, and then I transferred out west to go to school, got into the SMP program I told you about, where you're jointly in ROTC, and then you're also in the National Guard.
Right.
And between the GI Bill, my cadet stipend, and the pay I got for being a National Guardsman,
it largely covered my
tuition and the cost of going to school.
The GI Bill... For our generation, and obviously the World War II generation,
right.
got me through undergraduate and graduate school. Many thanks to the folks who passed that.
Sure. So from there, I was commissioned out of ROTC. I did my active duty at Fort Huachuca, where I did my officer basic course. From there, I was actually appointed to a civilian position in the CIA as an intelligence analyst. And did that for a couple of years before I decided to go back to academics.
That's a pretty interesting background. We've got a PhD in Native American some activities.
Well, part of it was I wanted to do work that if you're in the agency and you leave, if you do any publishing, it's anywhere near the area that you were in, it has to be reviewed.
Okay.
So one of my kind of rationales for what I did is I wanted to do something completely separate from my experience in government
service. So there won't be any complications.
Correct.
Yeah. And you should be congratulations. First of all, thank you for serving.
No, thank you.
And the other thing is that making from an E-1 to a captain's not a bad jump, is it?
It wasn't too hard. I think I was always destined to go that direction with my family history, but I really loved my military service.
Good.
It did a lot for me.
What branch? This was all intelligence, MI?
I was in the Army, and it was military intelligence.
Okay.
And then towards the end of my career, because of the opportunities in Oklahoma, I went into civil affairs, which back during World War II was actually called military government.
Oh, right.
And so what civil affairs does, and most of the assets are in the civilian world, we're economists and college professors and that kind of thing. And our role is to go into countries that have been obviously impacted by war and rebuild infrastructure. So that was what I was trained
Interesting
to do.
Work. Right? Very,
yeah,
interesting.
Very interesting work.
Now, before we go into all the good things that is going on at Chesapeake College, how about tell me, this is a great story, you were telling me off air, family relationship to General Westmoreland, who for a while was the most, well, during the whole Vietnam era, was probably the most important military man in this country.
He was basically, he and my grandfather were colleagues in Hawaii. They played baseball.
Oh, baseball.
Before the war, there were several routes to basically be noticed in a very difficult environment to get promoted.
Okay.
And you could play polo, and you could play baseball. And so my grandfather, who'd actually had a scholarship at Purdue in addition to his ROTC experience as a baseball player, he was a shortstop for the Purdue baseball team.
Oh, wow.
He basically did very well.
Playing shortstop on a Big Ten team, that's pretty decent.
Well, I know that was the case back in those days. Is that what was called? He certainly wasn't on television or anything like that. But the connection with General Westmoreland is that Westmoreland was my grandfather's best man. He, at the time, was, I think, a first lieutenant or a captain. And my grandfather was just
a brand new
lieutenant.
Next thing you know, he has 5 stars on his shoulder.
Next thing you know, and they obviously did very well. General Westmoreland became senior commander at the highest level. And my grandfather, ultimately retired as a colonel. So
great
they had connections on and off during the war and after is a very small community, as you well know.
Oh, the military,
in the
yes,
Army.
Yes.
And you see people over time, especially if you're in a career path. And but anyways, that's General Westmoreland's connection.
And that's a great story. It all is. The veterans are applauding as we speak.
Yeah.
Now, one of the things I've talked about with all, we'll switch now back to education. Very interesting. We can do a whole show, okay? One day you're going to come on.
Sure.
We're just going to talk about Coppersmith, okay? Having been in education 40 years, I don't know how you educators did it last year. I mean, I have grandchildren that I was helping teach for a while.
Sure.
My wife, she retired this year just because she said, Fred, there's been so many changes. I've been teaching in a virtual way. I've been teaching in live in person, combination of both. And it was changing so rapidly. And nobody's fault, it's just the COVID. First of all, congratulations on guiding any educational institution through that. How did you do last year?
We did okay. There were issues and challenges. We lost some students along the way who simply either didn't have Wi-Fi connectivity, the technology to do online, or just didn't do well in the online environment.
Right.
You know, that's a whole nother layer of challenge for students who are already academically challenged. But that being said, we were successful with most of our students. We saw good passage rates. We went completely online at the beginning of the crisis, as everybody did. But as soon as possible, that next summer, we got our health professions back on campus, and they've been back on campus ever since. That following autumn, a year ago, we got our skilled trades back up, our continuing ed back up. And of course, we've been trying to get students back on campus in a regular way ever since this last June when we brought all our employees back.
Well, I guess that opens the door. What are plans for fall semester 2021-22 school year?
Fall semester, we are roughly about 45% on campus, 55% online.
Oh, so it's almost a 50-50
split. We're trying to get there. We've got continuing ed back on track. We have all our skilled trades back on track. And then, of course, we have a pretty good general education schedule so that students that want to transfer can get back on campus, and that's your Englishes and Maths.
Sure.
And in particular, developmental education. Those are the students that would be the most impacted by online education, and we felt it very important to get them back
on campus
for not only those developmental courses, but also for all the services we provide. Not only do we go online for instruction, but all our services, financial aid,
anything you
advising,
need to do online.
Placement
testing,
all that stuff.
You have a great website. Everyone does your website, double their salary. It's really
well, we're working on that. Yeah. That's going to be a major improvement point for us in the coming year. But we did okay, and we're anxious to get back to as much as we can do on campus as possible. The one thing is, before COVID, we had roughly about a third of our schedule was already online.
Already online.
And that's just where students want to be met today.
Sure.
You know, you remember night school?
Yes.
And we still do that. But more and more students really prefer the convenience of online education.
Well, let me ask a question. We're filming this before Labor Day, and this show will get on starting in a couple of days.
Sure.
If I'm out there now watching a show, and I'm saying, you know what? I'm just graduated from high school. Do I still have time?
Oh, absolutely.
Walk me through the procedure if I'm first generation college.
Well, the best thing to do if you can is get to campus, and then you get that face-to-face experience.
And you just drive up to the campus?
You just drive in, you park. Now we're masking.
Everyone to wear a mask.
Everybody's wearing a mask at this point indoors.
Okay.
And but other than that, it's the same thing that you would have experienced 2 years ago.
Okay.
Come onto campus, the Dorchester buildings where our services are. You can get applied,
see counseling staff,
get your counseling, get your financial aid, if you need a placement test, all that stuff, and there's still time. Classes begin next week, but we would enroll students, you know, into the second or third week of the semester.
Okay, so but you still have time to do it. We're pre-Labor Day, so there's time. Okay.
Right.
Now, do we still do the testing services before? And I apologize, I should have done truth in advertising. I worked for Chesapeake College 5 years, so there's no greater supporter. When I was there, and you tell me, do the students still do, so if they need some help in math?
Do
we still help
them? We placement test to see where they place for math and English, which, of course, many students are challenged by those topics. And in particular, even our graduating high school students, for example, many high school students do not take math their senior year.
No.
That's a problem.
They've forgotten.
Particularly if you want to go into algebra, and you haven't had it since you were a freshman or sophomore, you just forget that stuff.
You do.
So we placement test to make sure we get students in the right class so they're successful.
Okay.
Yeah, so we're still doing that.
So you're helping them out there. And you still have a counseling staff. Again, I'll help you. You need English 101. We'll get you on a two-year program to transfer or whatever.
We have advising for both four-credit students who are going the traditional college route, but also for our workforce students who are going into either short-term, non-credit.
If I can interrupt, I apologize. County Commissioner Jack Wilson was all excited. Now, we'll talk about that perhaps you all are going to help with the CTE program.
Oh, sure.
We want to talk about,
No, it's a great segue, and I did watch that show, so I know.
Oh, he was more excited off air. Yeah.
So we've really worked hard to get our CE, and what we call applied technology in the college level is CTE in the high school level.
And for us old-timers, that's for old vocational education.
Well, it's a lot different than those days. Everything's very high-tech today. We have computers in those labs. For example, our truck driving program, we just bought a simulator, which allows our students to replicate driving conditions that we could never replicate.
I see them driving around occasionally. Yeah.
So that simulator, they can go into the port of Baltimore. We would never do that with a student with a real truck. They can drive in urban traffic. They can drive with bad weather. And so that's an example of how technology is even impacting our CDL truck driving program. So they get that experience, and then they're on the road with the trucks. Our welding program has simulators. We are looking at getting into advanced manufacturing. Mm-hmm. We've started a new marine trades program that's doing very well. We have a laboratory that's just bursting with outboard engines and Volvo diesel engines. And we're really excited about these programs because they're great places to go to work. There's tons of jobs. The starting wages
Every place I drive for higher.
It's incredible.
Higher, yes.
And starting wages are anywhere from $30 to $40 an hour.
Oh, good.
And of course, once you're a journeyman, you know what you're doing, the sky's the limit.
And it just takes off.
Yeah, there's six-digit incomes in some of these fields for students that have been at it for 5 or 6 years. So we're really excited to get that back on track. We're working on culinary as well. We know that's
cooking institute.
Right.
There's one in, we went to West Point, and there's a famous, and I can't remember, Culinary Institute, Hyde Park, where Franklin Roosevelt lived, and we had the best meal we've ever had in our lives. So I'm going to be out there every day at noon, okay?
Well, I do have some notes because this is fairly complicated. Yeah. We're working with the Queen Anne's County School District for a program that begins on January 2022. That will be
only a year away.
Yes, 6 months away. Yeah. Youth Apprenticeship Culinary Training Program, in which the high school is doing the instruction, but because of our instructional kitchen, which is in the TPAC, they'll be doing their classwork on campus.
Oh, wow.
So that's in this spring. We're real excited about that. We're working with the Maryland Food Works at Phillips Packing House and Cambridge Center to start a program in the next fall that will be a partnership that will bring a 12-week intensive culinary training program to Cambridge. And obviously, students here could take advantage of that.
There's still the satellite center in Cambridge?
Yes, we still have the center. Okay. It's alive and well. It's been reinvigorated. We have new leadership down there with Brandon Hessen. And we're really excited about Cambridge. If you haven't been there, with this fantastic mural.
It used to be in an old armory. Is it still in the old armory?
No, it's actually the old Leggett department store. But you'd never recognize it today when you go inside. But we have a beautiful mural that features the wildlife and landscapes of the Eastern Shore on the front building that we did in partnership with one of our local foundations. And it's just fantastic artwork. And then finally, we are working on a program in hospitality and restaurant management.
Which is perfect for Queen Anne's County and the Shore.
It's a very high-demand field, and we're hoping to get that going by the fall of 23.
Oh, wow.
So there's a lot going on in that hospitality area that is such interest in.
Well, I know you're the local one county commissioner anyway. He's more excited about that, I think, than a new Bay Bridge or whatever, right?
Right. our counties, all of our counties, have been very supportive of the college.
And we got to remind everybody, you serve five counties.
Five.
This is not a one-county show.
No, this is
five.
The only one in the state of Maryland of five. There's a couple with three, and of course, we're Maryland's first regional college, the first of its kind that's multi-county. But we've had great support from our counties. We love our county managers, our county administrators, our council members, and our commissioners. They really
do. So it's all working.
They take care of us.
It's all working. Chesapeake College, I always think of Chesapeake College of 400. How many full-time students do we have out there now, approximately?
Numbers all over the place over the last 2 years. Okay. We actually started recovering enrollment just before COVID, and COVID kind of knocked us down a bit. But we have a headcount. We have over almost 1,700 students registered for fall.
You have 1,700. Okay.
And that's for credit. So on top of that, we do non-credit, which is everything from real estate class.
And blend that in when you're ready. Talk about that program.
So that program, in addition, anywhere with enrollments that have been kind of all over the map in the last year and a half, we serve between 3,500 and 7,500 students in an average year.
That's a lot of people for the
shore. That's a lot of people.
Right?
Yes, and as you know, you can't go anywhere in this region and not find somebody with a direct connection to Chesapeake.
No, they're either running something, or they have transferred, or they have a job making more money than I've ever seen, which is great.
So continuing ed includes, that kind of continuing education for workforce training. Sometimes it's short term. We have programs, everything from veterinary science and clinical technicians. We have a medical office assistant. We have dental assistant. I just had my teeth cleaned this morning by my dental hygienist, who started at Chesapeake as a dental assistant, then got her prereqs, and she went to the community college at Baltimore County to get her two-year degree. But there's just extraordinary opportunities in all of these areas. And we have I need to get a copy of this to you. We have a guide for all our non-credit and for-credit workforce programs. So students that are interested in that can see what the program is, what the jobs are available, the pay rates in those positions, and how long it takes to get there and how much it costs. The other thing I want to add is extraordinary financial resources right now.
And please talk about that. That's important to everybody, yeah.
We have Pell Grants, which we've always had.
The traditional fill out the Pell form.
That's federal financial aid, right. But we also have state programs. And the Workforce Investment Board, which of course is on our campus, has over 22 streams of funding right now if you want to go to school. Hmm. Whether it's CDL truck driving, you want to be an English major, all these streams of funding will help you go to school.
The money's there if you want to go.
The money is there. There's really no financial reason that you can't go to college right now. There's just so much help available.
I mean, I encourage everybody out there, if you're thinking about a credit or non-credit course, and especially you young people who've just graduated from the high school in the last year or two, there's nothing to lose by driving out to Y Mills.
Right.
It's an hour of your time, maybe two max, to take the test. And the tests are just to help you. And then they put you on a program, and 2 years from now, you can end up at Salisbury State or Salisbury
Correct.
University,
right.
Towson, or where, University of Maryland, or wherever.
And we even have some four-year and graduate programs at our higher ed center.
Okay.
So, for example, in education, business, criminal justice, social work, there are several programs that are offered by our four-year partners. So there are some program areas where you can do your whole undergraduate degree and your graduate degree right at Chesapeake.
Now, make sure I'm correct in this. One of the teachers told me you can actually become a teacher. In other words, you go through the whole, going through your 2 years as a community college, and then with your partner programs, and you can end up with a certification to teach.
That is correct. And we actually they offer the superintendent certificate via distance that's available on our campus. So there's a lot in the education field you can do right at Chesapeake.
Do you still do an old catalog, or is it all online now?
We have an online catalog for credit, and we're talking about going back to a print catalog, at least in some limited sense. All our workforce stuff is in a catalog we actually mail to your house.
Okay, so that comes to everybody in your five.
We've had that back on track for the last year or so.
Yep. Okay. I mean, it's not only is the price right, the opportunities for financial aid are great, counseling services, I'm sure, are terrific. And it's an environment where you don't sit in a government 101 class with 300 or 400 other students.
No.
It's like, wow, the teacher might get to know my name. And if I'm having a little trouble, I might get a phone call. It's not a graduate assistant, right? It's a master's degree plus professor.
Sure.
That type
we have
of thing.
Highly credentialed faculty, both full and part-time. Our classes are very small. Some of the trade classes, I don't think you have more than 10 or 14 students.
Oh, so they're perfect.
And even the English and math courses, you're not going to see more than 25 to 30 students in a single section. So the class size is really very positive. You get a lot of personal attention. Your faculty know who you are. They know what your name is.
It's nice to go your first 2 years and walk in your
absolutely.
First class. I mean, as an 18-year-old kid or 50-year-old man, you're scared to death of English 101, and then someone in the second class knows, hey, Fred, how you doing? Did we able to read the book?
Right.
That's different than other schools that I've been to where the first class, you're sitting down with a graduate assistant says, I don't know who you are. Here's my name. And your name, your grades will be reported every day by your Social Security number. Come on, what is this?
The other thing we haven't talked about is dual enrollment.
Please.
Which is the opportunity that high school students
have. I have a granddaughter doing that.
They can take college classes right in their high school. They can do it online, or they can actually come to campus.
Okay.
And we've got a great example of how well this can work. We have a student who was actually part of the Midshore Scholars Program from Talbot County. Completed her associate degree at Chesapeake before she graduated from high school. And she's going to Dartmouth this
going
fall.
To Dartmouth, an Ivy Leaguer.
Yes.
Oh, Lord. I mean, what a great opportunity. Not only do kids mature more, I think, by going to the college or however how they take the course, but mom and dad, your daughter graduates from high school, and all of a sudden, she's got 30 college credits also.
Sure.
I mean, you just save, what, 10...
Tens of thousands of dollars.
Yeah.
If you were going to pay for that at a private four-year or even a public four-year, you can save so much money by having your student complete at least a semester or two before they go to their four-year institution.
Well, the McNeil family endorses, because I have a granddaughter, and she'll graduate in another year. She'll have college credits. And the nice thing, people need to know, right? You have agreements with the state universities anyway.
Sure.
About those, if you take, no one's going to go to you, not English, then 101 doesn't count. There are agreements so those credits do transfer, right?
Well, there are occasions when 4 years don't accept a credit. That's very rare.
Very rare.
But we have a very solid partnership, and most of our students go to Salisbury.
Okay.
Just because of proximity and the
Eastern Shore, it's Eastern Shore.
Right.
Thing, yeah.
But our students go everywhere. University of Maryland, another dual enrollment student who did very well, this year is going to the University of Puget Sound to major in sociology.
Oh, wow.
So you literally can go anywhere in the world from Chesapeake, and especially our four-year institutions here in the state of Maryland.
And also, I know you do, but we really encourage this, what I call the senior learner. I'm not sure what we're calling them anymore. Folks, if you haven't tried college, or maybe you tried and it didn't work out, by going to Chesapeake, you're going to reinforce their good skills. Don't worry about the negatives, and you're going to walk them. I mean, it's tough if you're 40 years old to go back. And
that's a population we love to serve, and we'd love to see them in our classes. They definitely bring a whole added aspect of life to a classroom that all students would benefit from. Whether you know, were there and you stopped, we have some students that are probably just a few classes from getting their associate degree completed. We ask them to come in.
Get it done.
We'll help them get it done. Yeah. You get that credential, and you can move on to either a job or four-year academic work.
Sure.
So, yeah, we really welcome our adult students. We really want them to come.
And I know Chesapeake does a good job. You're not going to be out of place when you go to class and you say, oh, they're going to be all 18-year-old kids or 20-year-old kids. No, it's going to be your age group there, many of the students, and age is not a factor when you go to college.
Age is not a factor, and you know, many of our workforce programs, that is who is in the classroom, particularly in the health professions. You see people transitioning from one career to the next or upskilling themselves in their current profession, and so you'll see adults on campus. And the other thing is, if you're an adult and you really don't want to be in a classroom on campus, we have our online programs.
Okay.
So there's lots of ways to complete your education, and we're going to try to make it as easy for you to do it as possible and to keep the cost as low as
and
possible.
And it's a lot of fun, whether it's dual enrollment or old guys like me going back to school. You've got an atmosphere where you feel comfortable.
Sure. Let me,
I always like to, where do you see Chesapeake College? We'll put our dream things. Where are we headed? Where do you see the college going down the road? It will continue. When I was there, there was, I think, the admin building, the student center, and maybe one or two. You're growing with this wonderful health center. Do you see what's going to happen?
I don't think that you won't see too many changes in campus.
Okay.
We currently have plenty of space. The HPAC project, which is the Health Professions and Athletic Center.
Beautiful building.
Beautiful building. We just put a brand new gym floor in.
Oh, wow.
That had to be replaced with some water damage. But the campus itself, there is a construction project that many people have noticed recently. Mm-hmm. It's a conservation project on the north side of campus where we're trying to control some of our soil and water erosion and also deal with some flooding problems we have in our parking lots.
Okay.
So that's what that project has been. There's bulldozers
been out
there.
That's a maintenance type thing, yeah.
So ultimately when that's finished, it's going to be, I think, 10 acres of restored wetlands. There's going to be two ponds in there. There's going to be a walking trail, outdoor lab for biology classes.
Yeah.
And it would really just, I think, look really great.
It'll look nice.
And it helps us conserve our resources and prevent things from getting into the bay. So that's probably the only construction project I would see in terms of big picture. We're currently trying to improve our workforce facilities. So that's renovations with the current buildings we have, including the Manufacturing Trade Center and the Queen Anne's Tech Building. And we're looking for some private assistance there, which we are getting some significant help there. And I'll be talking more about that in the coming months. But right now, I think campus is going to be solid. We have great facilities. Our health professions labs are state-of-the-art.
I've visited
them. They're world-class.
We filmed the show out there. They're brilliant.
The nursing simulation, paramedic, our rad tech program, our surg tech program. These are facilities that cannot be beat anywhere in the state of Maryland.
So they're equivalent to Montgomery County or Baltimore
City? Equivalent
or
better.
Oh,
we have very good facilities for our health professions. And I got to brag, our nursing class, they had 100% passage rate on their NCLEX exam.
Is Nancy Pippin with you now?
No.
Is that anything about?
I know the name. I don't think she's with it. So our nursing program is doing very well, and our nursing director was just appointed to the state nursing board.
Oh, terrific.
So our nursing program is really doing quality work and really preparing students for these really challenging fields.
Now, a question I have to ask you, a neighbor asked me, how about extracurricular activities for the students, sports or theater? A lot of people say, oh, community college, you just get in your car, go to class, and go home. I don't think that's true.
Well, we are a community campus, but we have athletics.
Okay.
We have both men and women's sports, soccer, volleyball, basketball, baseball. Our baseball team has produced some National League players over the last 20 years. So there's games to go to, particularly if we get over COVID.
The cheering or playing.
We have drama programs. Okay. We have a very active, and again, before COVID, we have a partnership with the Avalon Foundation. We had some top headliner acts, including America, Clint Black. We had Melissa Etheridge, and we had one other.
It's a beautiful facility, it's beautiful. By the way.
The TPAC is gorgeous. We just got it all renovated, new seats, new rugs, and painted and so forth. And, of course, COVID came in and shut that down, so we're very anxious to get that back. So the campus is a full experience campus, except you can't live there.
Right. Okay.
We're a commuting campus. There's only two of the 16 colleges in Maryland have dorms, so most of our community colleges in Maryland are commuting.
And everybody, look, mom's cooking or dad's cooking is a lot better than school lunches I had at the University of Maryland. You're better.
Well, we have a great contractor. Sodexo does our food services.
Does ours, too, for the county.
We're going to have them back. They're already serving lunch, and as soon as the students are back, we're hoping to maintain it. At least a breakfast and lunch, and then some kind of offering for evening classes in the HPAC.
Okay.
So we will have food services on campus.
Now, with a couple minutes we have left, let me just kind of review everything. We're about 50-50 this fall.
Sure.
Coming up for classes, if I want to take a class.
That is correct.
Still, we're before Labor Day when we're filming this. The class is going to start here soon, but there's still time.
There's still time, and community college students are notorious for procrastinating.
Okay.
So if you have decided to go to school and you still want to get in classes for fall, it's not too late.
And it's a painless experience. I mean, you just go.
Well, there's things you got to get done. You got to get that FAFSA form completed to get your financial aid. There's some forms to fill out, but we are going to help you all along the way. It's very easily done. You can get everything you've done in maybe an hour or less to come on campus. And of course, we have online services as well. So if you want to come online, just go to the website, chesapeake.edu, and you can get all the help you need online.
Okay. And for those of you that want to find a career, we have 1 and 2 year programs. You can do it. If you want to transfer,
We have some programs are several weeks, a couple of months. Whether you're CNA, CDL truck driving, you can get a welding certificate. With a little investment, you can get yourself a credential and go right to work and make a pretty decent wage.
And all my people who are thinking, you know, I might want to teach, you can do it all, right? Through your partner program, right?
We're always
right?
looking for good faculty, so out there that's interested
in teaching. Get that master's degree out there.
Yes, that would be great.
Now, if someone's watching this show and say, wow, your first piece of advice is go to the website.
Correct.
Do you know that website, by the way?
Chesapeake.edu.
Okay, one more time.
Chesapeake.edu.
Okay, and now if they're old school like me, I don't want to go to the website. Is there a phone number they can call and be directed to a counseling center?
You know, let me get that to you. I have my business card, but I don't know the general phone number.
Don't worry about it, but there, you can call the...
But it's on the website as well.
Yeah, and just simply, if you're someone like me says, I like to talk to a real person, you have wonderful operators out there.
We do. There's lots of help on the phone, and if you want to just drop in during the regular workday, Monday through Friday, 8:30 to 5 o'clock, and then we do have extended hours in some cases after 5 during the week from Monday to Thursday.
Okay.
But we're there all during the workday. Just drop in and we'll take care of you.
Okay. Everybody out there, please, we don't know where we are in this COVID thing, but one of the great opportunities you have is right in Y Mills. I don't care if you're in Kent Island. Don't cross that bridge and go, there's nothing wrong with those schools, but come right here. Wonderful opportunity to take part in programs that can change your life. Change your economic life and just open doors to a whole different
world. It's a great time to get going to school. It really is. We want to encourage everybody, especially those that have taken a break because of all the craziness out there. Now's the time to go to college. There's all kinds of great opportunities and ways to do it in terms of paying for it.
And I can't think of a friendlier place to do it than Chesapeake College.
It's your college.
That's right. It's right. So, well, thank you very much, Dr. Coppersmith, okay? And we're going to have you back, and we're just going to talk about old war experiences
whatever. Sure, anytime.
Right? Any man, his family knows the General Westmoreland I like. All right?
Thank you, Fred.
Thank you for being with us. My name's Fred McNeil. Thank you for your time. My time's up. We're going to see you next time.